Willkommen hier zur sechsten Folge von 60s Kilometer. Ich hoffe, in dieser Folge werden wir noch ein bisschen mehr über den Typen erfahren. Und ich habe mir mal so ein bisschen Gedanken gemacht, also ich fange jetzt schon mal mit Kapitel 4 an und erzähle währenddessen weiter. Ich habe mir schon so ein bisschen Gedanken gemacht und da stand ja am Anfang, dass irgendwie Leute geraped werden in diesem Spiel. Und dann habe ich mich gefragt, wer wird denn geraped? Denn wir haben ja bis jetzt eigentlich erst zwei Frauen kennengelernt. Die eine sah eher so aus, als wollte man sie nicht rapen. Und wer die andere geraped wird? Naja, wie auch immer. Lass uns erstmal die Story von dem Typen hier betrachten. I went to my summer cottage by car. That day was very important. Construction materials would be delivered and builders would come to discuss the details of the future work. I planned to finish construction of my summer cottage by the end of the year. My mother and wife were waiting for me. The day before they had stayed there. I had gone to the city because I didn't want to spend a night in the barn. Moreover, there was no place for me to sleep. We had only two old beds there. A phone rang, and I answered, driving the car with one hand. Yes? Good morning, Alexei. Morning, how are you? Plans haven't changed? No, but I may be late for 10 minutes. So if you see a white gazelle, open the gates. Okay, good luck. After the conversation, I switched off the phone. It was my colleague. He'd agreed to help me to deliver the construction materials, because his car was applicable for this purpose. I closed the window as there was a chilling wind, and I didn't want to catch a cold. I just didn't have time to be ill. Gradually, the forest was over. I saw familiar fields. There was a little distance to my summer cottage. I noticed something unusual in that place. After a while, I understood what the matter was. The clouds were becoming pink. They didn't look lit by sunset. They were much brighter. Suddenly, I looked like somebody put a huge pink glass between the sun and the earth, and it colored the rays of the light coming through. I couldn't even imagine what happened. Different thoughts came to my mind. A car passed by me. Looking in a side view mirror, I noticed it went to the wrong way and then fell into a ditch. I hit the brake pedal immediately and took the phone. My hands were shaking. I dialed 02, but there was no connection. Shit. What am I going to do? How can I help him? What happened? Maybe he was drunk, so a sudden thought came to my mind. Maybe it happened because of the pink smoke. That seemed to be logical. If it was toxic, he could get poisoned and lost consciousness. That could explain everything. The windows of my car were closed. That was good. I wouldn't take risks and check my guess. I was thinking what to do. Should I leave the car and take a risk to continue my journey? Should I leave the car and take a risk or continue my journey? While I was thinking, I saw one more car. It was old and yellow. An old man drove it. He saw me and hit the brake. He stopped the car beside mine and opened the door. Can you tell me what? He didn't finish his phrase. Instead of it, he touched his throat and fell to the ground with a croaky sound. My heart was beating madly. Thousands of thoughts floated in my mind. I was shocked from what I had seen. Suddenly, I held my breath and opened the door. The pink smoke started filling my car, but I didn't pay attention to it. I picked up the old man and dragged him into the car. He was surprisingly light, or my body might become stronger, affected by a dose of adrenaline. I got into the car and closed the door. I didn't put my hand away from my nose. I would hold my breath as long as I could. I didn't know what to expect because there was a lot of toxic air inside the car. 5 seconds passed. 10 seconds. I couldn't stand it anymore. I took my hand away, furiously, and pressed in. Nothing happened. I could breathe easily. Perhaps I managed to not let much smoke into the car. My breath recovered. I felt dizzy and my lungs hurt. I turned back and looked at the old man. His face was exhausted. I felt pity for him. I checked his pulse. He was alive. I saved him. So what would I do? I decided not to sit there and wait when it would be over, but keep on my journey to the summer cottage. I wondered if my relatives were alive. Aber das heißt, wenn die Leute früh genug aus dem Nebel zieht, dann überleben sie das. Heißt, meine Entscheidung ganz am Anfang war ja doch gar nicht so falsch, direkt rauszurennen und versuchen, ihn zu retten. Zugegeben, hätte der Charakter dabei nicht atmen sollen. Das war ein bisschen unlucky. Na dann, mal schauen, ob die noch leben. I heard some noise from the back seat, where the old man said he was regaining consciousness. What happened? He asked, trying to clear his throat. You got out of the car and tried to ask something. Oh yes, what am I doing in your car? And what a strange smoke is outside. You fainted. I dragged you in the car. I don't know anything about the smoke, but I think it's toxic. Really? So what are we going to do? After this question, I started coughing again. He started coughing again, as if suffocated. I don't know. I have to check my relatives. They are not far from here. Let's go then. I'll leave my car here. You won't need it anymore. It's full of gas. Thank you for saving me. You're welcome. Do you have anything to drink? I feel dry. Unfortunately, I haven't got anything. I started the engine and we departed. The old man coughed heavily. He touched his breast and went on groaning. I pressed the gas pedal. I was afraid that it would be late, that my relatives could die. Summer cottages could be seen ahead. There was our newly bought lot. I was driving from my vegetable garden, which is not far from here. Now I know some of my neighbors. I drove towards our lots. There were no people around. Everything was silent, and only the sound of my car could be heard. Und ich speichere mal kurz. Some time had passed before I came to my lot. Now I meet my relatives and take them away from here. Old man, here? Yes, stay inside and don't leave the car. I'll be quick. I inhaled as much air as I could. I got out of the car and closed the door quickly. Opened the gate. There was our lot. A couple of apple trees. Beds with onion, cabbage and other vegetables. A small shabby barn. I took a few steps and saw it. My mother was lying near the cabbage beds with a rake in her hands. No, it can't be true. My hands shook. My heart was beating madly. Adrenaline started spreading across my body. I wanted to run away. I wanted to forget all this. I wanted to wake up. I wish it were a nightmare. But everything looked quite realistic. It wasn't a dream. I came to the old lady and touched her. She was cold. I couldn't believe it. I came closer to the barn and saw my wife's body. Her eyes were wide open. I couldn't look at it. I turned back and went to my car. I opened the door and got on the driver's seat. What's there? I couldn't answer him. I was dry in my mouth. I could hardly say anything. Can you wish such death to anybody? When a person did some work for herself and her relatives, she wanted us to have a good harvest, to care of planted vegetables. No one deserves such death. It seemed to me the last thoughts of dying people were incomprehension, fear and obscurity of what was happening. What's there? They're dead. I was afraid of my own birds. Dead, my nearest and dearest. I was left alone. I didn't want to live. If they're dead, I had nothing to do here. I wouldn't be able to enjoy my life. It's all over. The old man was upset and anxious too. He was still holding his chest and coughed. He looked at me, then lowered his eyes. I let the arm on the handle and opened the door. The man understood what I was going to do. Don't do it. Why? Nothing's left in my life. They were my dearest people. I can't live without them. The main thing is that you're alive. God saved your life. It was made for a reason. Then why did he take the life of such good people? I shouted angrily and hit the rudder. It's their fate, and you can't do anything about it. But don't think it's the end. I'm sure you'll have happy days when you understand that committing suicide is an absurd idea. I pointed to the pink mist and said, "Do you mean that this is the visitation of God?" "Who knows, who knows?" The old man started coughing. "What's wrong?" "I can't clear my throat. My lung hurts." I was absorbed in thoughts. I didn't know how to live without those people. "Don't give up. You have a lot of time. You'll learn to live without them." "How can you know? You don't know me. You can't know what will happen to me." He just tried to calm me down, but I only shouted at him. I was shocked, and he didn't believe his words. "I just give you hope." I didn't need hope. I didn't believe it. I believed in reality, and I couldn't change it. I hated time. Only an hour ago everything was all right, and they were alive. I couldn't even think that something could go wrong. Everything changed. What are we going to do? I need to think it over. We can try to find survived people. Let's try. There should be others who survived. What if... I started the car and we continued our journey. We were running out of petrol. We have to fuel the car. There's a petrol station not far from here. We can look for the survived there. I nodded. We saw a car left on the road. When we drove closer, we noticed the driver. His body lay on the road. What the hell is going on? The old man crossed himself. Soon we approached the petrol station. We didn't meet any cars on our way there. The petrol station was quite small, and the shop adjusted to it. On the other side, there was a truck without a driver. Near no one of the filling columns, there was a car with an open door. When we drove closer, we saw a dead body near the counter. The smoke had reached him when he had to pay for the petrol. I approached to the filling column and said to the old man, "First, I'll go to the shop. People may be there. I'll take something to drink." "Yes, that's what we need." I breezed in, got out of the car and went towards the shop. I came in slowly. The pink smoke was inside. A few people lay on the floor. I didn't want to stay here. I found some bottles of mineral water, took them and went back to my car. I got in and recovered my breath. "Here's water. Take it." He was silent. I looked at him. He didn't move. His eyes were closed. I touched him. There was no heartbeat. Dead. Perhaps he breathed in too much toxic air. That was enough for him. I was left alone. I had felt better talking to him. Now I was in panic. I took a sip of mineral water. It was strange that I felt all right. I had opened the door several times, letting the smoke inside, but mixing with the air in the car, it became not so hazardous. I needed to fuel the car. I had to go to the counter to turn on a filling column. I could enter it through the shop. Having got in, I tried to switch on the light. Shit, there was no electricity. And the filling column didn't work either. I returned to my car depressed. I couldn't go far from this place. Petrol would be enough for a few kilometers. I could have tried to take some petrol from the nearest car manually, but for this I had to breathe in air. But the air was toxic, so I considered it was a bad idea. My head was empty. I couldn't think of anything. I just stayed in the car and waited when somebody would come and save me. I waited for 10 minutes, then 30 minutes, then an hour. But nothing happened. I couldn't rely on anybody, so I started thinking. It's strange that the smoke was inside the shop, because its door and windows were closed. How had it seeped in? And why didn't it seep into the car? So where can I find people around here? is far from the city. I wouldn't get there. Summer cottages? No, I had already been there. What else was there? A small village, but the situation seemed to be the same as with the summer cottages. There was also a railway line, not far from it. Electricity was switched off everywhere, so trains had stopped, and there could be a lot of people. It got dark while I had waited. The sun was setting over the horizon. The stars which appeared in the sky had a strange color. I knew where to go. I started the engine and departed. I only worried about the petrol. Soon I was approaching the road's dead end. A little distance was left. I hoped my car would pass this test. I had to drive on grass, numerous hill rocks and pits right to the railway line. At the moment I regretted that I hadn't bought a Land Rover. It would have been much easier, because I had to drive round every possible hill rock and didn't want to get stuck there. A strip of the trees separated the railway line from the field. I found a space between the trees where I could drive to the bank. If I went along the rail track, I would have a chance to meet a train. Having driven a few kilometers, I saw a train. When I got close to it, I noticed a dim light in its windows. People were there. Finally, I knew that I wasn't alone. I knew that many people had got in the same situation. Having approached its first carriage, I signaled. In a few seconds, I saw a man opening the train's door. He ran towards my car and shouted, "Close your nose with arm and don't breathe." I opened the door and soon I was inside the train. Finally, I'm not alone. Das war Kapitel 4 und das war dann auch die sechste Folge von 60 Kilometer. Diesmal keine Entscheidung, sondern nur ein bisschen Story. Aber ich denke, auch das war ganz cool, so die Story aus der Sicht einer anderen Person zu erfahren. Und wenn euch interessiert, wie die Geschichte von allen diesen Personen zusammen jetzt weitergeht, schaut auch in der nächsten Folge rein. Bis dahin.